Firstly, thank you very much for coming. I'd like to share with you what we plan to cover in the next 30 minutes, just to whet your appetite and to get your engagement. So we are here to discuss what does ESG look like in the context of emerging markets. So we had this discussion at the Beyond ESG panel that ESG is changing. And it's changing because ESG as a concept has been perceived as being something that is a bolt-on to business, as opposed to being something that is an integral part of it. There's also a perception that ESG has been applied in a way as a cookie cutter, i.e. one size fits all. The purpose of this panel is to explore, well, what does actually ESG look like in the context of emerging markets? And for those of you that were at the London FII event, the FII Institute launched its inclusive ESG framework, which is a framework that gets exactly into that. So it starts to look at what does good ESG performance look like in the local context for specific markets, for specific issues, for specific sectors. And it sets out a framework for evaluating what good looks like. So over the next 28 minutes now, I'm going to get the esteemed panel's views on one, that framework. So they've all had the chance to have a look at it, and they've all had the chance to think about, well, what difference could this make in the context of my own business? I'm also going to ask them to get some feedback as well. Well, if this is going to get to scale and you're going to release some of those benefits and use cases, what needs to change? But I think most importantly, it's really benefiting from these gentlemen in terms of their experience of ESG on the front line in emerging markets and how to really get this contextualized locally. So hopefully that's going to be a very helpful discussion. So, gentlemen, it's been wonderful getting to know some of you this week, but also to rekindle friendships. So the first question that I'd like you to ask, and if you don't mind, as I ask you the question, maybe you could spend 30 seconds introducing yourself and your role, but then to respond to the question. Would that be all right? So I'm going to go along, or maybe I could mix it up a little bit so that it catches you by surprise. But I am going to go to Iyad first, if I may. Iyad, I know you've had the chance to have a look at the framework, and you were great in providing feedback as it was being developed. It'd be wonderful to understand the context of SABIC. What difference will it make for you, and how had you envisaged that it could be used, and what might be the benefits from that?
Great. First of all, assalamu alaikum and good day, everyone. It's really exciting, and I'm really having the pleasure to be a panel with you, Dag, and as usual, appreciating the initiatives and the exposure that FII is bringing on a global stage like this. I am Iyad Al-Gharawi, I'm the General Secretary of the Board of Directors for SABIC and the Investor Relations Officer. And ESG is integral in SABIC. I'm part of a Executive Steering Committee overseeing ESG within the SABIC group. And we've been very active in sustainability, issuing reports and transparency for more than a decade now. And we're working very hard also with FII on this particular framework. So the interest, maybe I'll step a little bit back and just give a reference point on the importance of ESG and the initiative that FII is doing here. The company I work for, SABIC, is a global company based in KSA, but it is one of the top three players in the global petrochemicals business. We have assets in more than 50 countries around the world. We serve customers in more than 100 countries around the world. We work with customers that you are all familiar with, the BMWs of the world, Unilever, Procter & Gamble, and a lot of the OEMs. And they work with us on a global basis. We work with them supplying material and also finding and discovering solutions jointly with them. So there is no difference for SABIC as a supplier of choice, whether in the kingdom, in Europe, in the US or even in Asia. We've been treated by our customers similar to all our global peers. The same thing applies for SABIC when we go and purchase materials or procure materials. The difference comes on the investor base. Mm. Because SABIC is headquartered in Saudi, it is linked as a government-related entity in one way or another. The investors look at SABIC differently. They look at it as an emerging market-based company. That's fine. They look at it from a risk portfolio, and they could segregate and see how the risk of investing in SABIC compared to our peer group. However, at least in our view, ESG should be indifferent when it comes to investors, whether they are investing in emerging market or in developed market. It should be risk-free. In my mind, it should be the other way around. If a company is based in developing or emerging markets, it should be even credited more from an ESG point of view because of the initiatives that it's doing. So if it's putting efforts and it's raising the bar for the emerging markets at a global standard, it should be given really more credit. Currently, if you see credit rating agencies or global ESG rating agencies, it's not the case. And this whole point is really in support for the initiative of the inclusive ESG, because inclusive ESG is given really a strong shot at making sure that investors can look at companies or entities without the, let's say, discrimination of where they're based.
Maybe I could bring you in, John, and maybe if you're happy just to introduce yourself first. But it'd be great from an investor perspective. We heard from Iyad that, you know, this is about, you know, we believe we're doing a really good job in how we're addressing the issues in the market, but we're being marked down because of this bias. How important is it you is it for an investor to really hone in on those issues that are most critical for the potential investments that you're looking at?
Doug, thank you, and really great to be here. Brief introduction to 91. I'm part of the executive team at 91. We're a investment management business. We've been in operation for 30 years. Our home is South Africa. That's where we started. Today, we're a global investment firm. So we believe we're one of the only global investment firms that started life in an emerging market. Mm. About 55% of our 170 billion that we run is an emerging market strategy. So this is something we're really passionate about. Mm. We are an investor in part of the capital issued by SABIC, so it's great to hear it from Iyad in terms of how they think. Mm. I think the issue that we see is that emerging market companies are assessed through the lens of developed market ESG scores. Typically, we as a firm are allergic to ESG scores because of that bias. Mm. And we're so allergic that we only got to look at the ESG framework when you called me up and said, come and participate in this panel. So that was an interesting takeout. And the really interesting thing for me was what this framework looks at is a couple of key things that we really like. So I asked our investment team independently, objectively, there's the framework, have a look at it 2 weeks ago, give me your assessment. And they came back and their first comment was, our allergy to ESG scores, most of the issues that we have with those scores have been addressed by this framework. So I think job really well done on that front. What are some of the things we really like? Some of the things we really like is the focus on rate of change. In emerging markets, the baseline is less important than the rate of change. Mm. And it's one of the key things that traditional emerging market metrics miss. They say, you know, are you at this point? No. Are you moving towards that point? Not assessed. So first thing is rate of change. We like. The second thing we really like is the focus on action. So many ESG scores look at, do you have a policy? Okay, if you have a policy, then you must be doing it. This framework looks at real action. And the third thing we like is the context of the countries and the markets you operate in. And that is so important where you have a GDP per capita range across developing markets that goes from, you know, $2,000 to $15,000. These are different markets with different levels of capability. And the last thing I would say is that with that as background, You know, it's one of the things that we think has been missed in the E and the S debate around ESG. The third paragraph of the preamble to the Paris Agreement says, we are committed to the principles of the convention, specifically the principle of equity and the principle of common but differentiated responsibility and relative capability. And that is something that we believe has been forgotten in the debate for ESG. And I'll come back to sharing a few stories around how we encounter investors' approach to emerging markets, where they just say, well, sorry, this portfolio is too carbon intensive. We're gonna redeem the portfolio. No thought about, is there a rate of change going on? Is there transition commitment going on? Mm. Is there social impact? The final point I'll make is that in emerging markets, you have this incredible intersection of E and S. Mm. This big debate in the ESG world now is, what about the S? Actually, in emerging markets, that intersection is incredibly powerful. If you address many of the challenges of the E, you also address many of the challenges of the S. So getting it right, getting a framework in place, we're fantastically excited about. So
brilliant,
great to
John,
be here.
Thank you. And thanks to your team as well for taking the time to look at it. Bada, it's been lovely getting to know you over the last day or so. And I loved learning about TDF and your passion for how the framework could be used in the context of your organization was very exciting. So it'd be lovely to get your reflections on that.
Thank you very much, Doug. Good afternoon to everyone. I think my colleagues, Iyad and John, actually summarized exactly what I wanted to say quite well. I would just like to add one more element. It's in its simplicity to be applied for SMEs. So when we talk about a sector such as tourism, which is inclusive by nature, and I'm sure you've heard we have aggressive targets when it comes to the tourism sector. We aim to have it as a key pillar in the Saudi economy, contributing 10% of our GDP and creating 1 million jobs. And many of these jobs are inclusive jobs in destinations that are currently suffering from high unemployment rates. Over 90% of these enterprises that work in tourism are small and medium enterprises. And as my colleagues have eloquently mentioned, it's unfair, it's an unfair playing field comparing the context of a country such as Saudi Arabia with other countries, and it's equally unfair to compare the capabilities of an SME or a new organization with a multinational corporate. So that allows us, from the Tourism Development Fund, to really measure each investment opportunity or each company or beneficiary in an equal, relative scale that allows them to improve rather than kind of corners them or challenge them, makes an ESG compliance a challenging activity rather than a road to success. So that's in a nutshell how we see it from the Tourism Development Fund. We aim, of course, with the collaboration with FII to replicate the sectors that are already in the framework in the tourism sector. And the beauty from our point of view is it will provide a feedback loop into what needs to be improved across not only the tourism sector, but across the entire value chain that we intersect with. Mm. And that is a practical benefit that I believe is missing today. We have, I believe it was over 27 government or kingdom level initiatives. We have more than 15 metrics that we are currently measuring at all sectors that we're trying to improve when it comes to ESG. But I think when it comes to practicality and linking the efforts that are being done from different organizations, this tool could be at the heart and soul of that activity.
Absolutely, brilliant, thank you. Oliver, firstly, thank you to Standard Chartered's feedback to the FII on the framework. It really did help as we developed it and refined it, so that was very gratefully received. I know that you've thought deeply about the difference that it can make in the context of Standard Chartered. So it'd be lovely to hear about some of the use cases that you've been envisaging. I think based on the conversation, there was quite a novel one that I think you have recently shared.
Well, Bader, if you thought it was bad going third, then imagine how I feel. I could just sit back and say, I agree with everything. That would make my life very easy. But at Standard Chartered, one of the things we really pride ourselves on is our unique role as a UK headquartered bank that is not at home in developed markets. We're at home in emerging markets, whether that's South Africa, whether that's here in Riyadh. Always feel a bit odd saying Riyadh is Saudi is an emerging market. I don't think it really is, but you know, emerging Asia and many other countries in Africa as well. And because of that, our role is really about how do we move capital from developed markets to emerging markets. And the challenge that I see every day in my role, which is leading our sustainable finance business for Africa and the Middle East, is that you're talking to someone who's applying that European-centric way of thinking, and they're trying to, you know, sort of round peg square hole it into emerging markets. And when I first heard from Tony and from you, Doug, about this tool, it just resonated exactly with the issue that we are grappling with every single day, which is how do you contextualize what good looks like when it comes to ESG in different countries? And particularly, how do you do that with an emerging markets focus? Mm. We kind of see that the traditional ESG ratings are not fit for purpose, even in developed markets, frankly, but even more so when you move out. And when you're starting to look at, you know, just have you got a policy, but not even have you got a policy, have you got a policy in the right place, in the right form, in a very obvious bit of the website so that someone can see it when they've done their 5-minute check. That does not tell you if someone is a leader from ESG, if someone is genuinely, you know, like Sabek is doing, taking ambitious, game-changing steps to really position itself in the best way possible for the future. So that's what I think is really powerful for this tool. And one of the ideas we've been sort of playing around with internally at the moment is taking it to an area which I don't think at the time we even envisaged as a possibility. It was a little bit of a light bulb moment that I had. We do a lot of sustainability linked loans. These are loans where there's no projects being funded as such, but we're using ESG KPIs and we're incentivizing borrowers to improve their performance little by little over time. It's not about saying I am green today, it's about saying I'm going to be better next year and the year after and the year after. And we contextualize those KPIs to the borrower and to the market. And what I found about this tool is a really interesting way of looking at it. First of all, we can look into what KPIs matter for a country. And what that allows you to do is bring that level of contextualization. Then thinking about, well, you know what, everyone's going to say we want emissions because that's the buzzword. Everyone cares about emissions. But you can then look at, in a country context, whether this company is already doing very well on emissions. But maybe water consumption is somewhere that where they lag a national average. And actually incentivizing them to improve on their water consumption is a better thing to do. And through this tool, what I think we can do is create a really objective way that when I go to a European bank and I try and sell them and get them to come into the syndicate, instead of them saying, well, MSCI says this or the EU taxonomy says this, I can use a data-led approach to show why we've chosen these KPIs, why the targets that we've come up with are ambitious, and why this is actually a better investment if they really want to drive positive action on ESG than another wind farm in Denmark.
Quite interesting, Oliver. I mean, just as you were speaking, I was thinking how similar that is to the use case that you were talking about, because it's basically about demonstrating, hey, what we're doing is exactly right for the local context and demonstrating the investment community that you're good. You're good at ESG in the context where you work. But John.
Just one more benefit to point out. I mean, yeah. You know, COP27 starts next week. Obviously, Conference of the Parties. It's a big policy and a big government conversation. And I think in the world of the E in ESG, it's often easy to defer to policy as the bottleneck, to defer to policy as the issue. But the one thing that we're seeing more and more and more is that if companies in emerging markets have a clear sense of what needs to happen.
Yep.
They put bottom-up pressure on governments to change. It's not top-down policy interaction. Big companies that are large employers have much more leverage over government behavioral change than external parties. And and giving them the framework and the guidance to say, if we do these things better, it will improve our standing as an investment proposition, it will reduce our cost of borrowing, etc. Creates, I think, an enormous bottom-up move to address these things in emerging market economies.
Of course, yep. Please.
Yeah, yeah. I couldn't agree more. And I think we, reflecting back on our 2 years since establishment at TDF, we were born out of the national tourism strategy that created three entities: the fund, the Ministry of Tourism, and the Saudi Tourism Authority, a regulator, a funding arm to support the private sector, and an entity responsible for promotion and creating demand. And the three of us share the same overall targets so that we can assure both investors and visitors that we're addressing and tackling all the common issues collectively. I mean, when I first joined TDF, I thought that it's all about the dollar sign. The capital is going to unlock the opportunities. And what I quickly realized is that it's the funding is the last. It's, of course, very important, but it comes at the very end. Data, synergy, policies, support, non-financial support are all prerequisites for a successful transaction.
It's quite interesting. It sounds to me, just building on your two comments, that what's needed is a new country assessment tool that actually looks at the enabling environment for doing good ESG within that market.
Absolutely.
It sounds as if that's absolutely critical.
And I think the debate is going to shift to bottom-up enablement.
Yeah.
So in South Africa recently, there was a change to regulation which said, essentially, corporates can generate however much electricity they like for themselves. Now, that is a fundamental change in enabling companies to really address some of these climate-related issues.
Yeah.
And the more of that happens, I think the more quickly emerging market companies can address these issues.
Brilliant. No, I get that. And I think that's a really point well made. So, Iyad, in terms of getting to where you want to get to in the application of the framework, what do you think needs to change in the framework to make it more useful to you for the use case that you talked about?
Sure. I mean, hearing my co-panelists, a fund manager, a country that is driving tourism through the lens of ESG, and a reputable bank talking about how ESG is not looked at from emerging or developed or looking at how progress is made. This was one of the items that we wanted really the framework to take into consideration. So hearing this is what's really important, is how much you are committed to change and how much progress you make towards this change. And you will get rewarded of how much progress basically you're, whether in the environment, whether in the social contribution, or how rigorous your processes and governance are done. With Badr's point, I think the kingdom's vision, I'm talking as a Saudi citizen here, putting aside that we're proud of it and it's something that we really take with really pride, from an ESG perspective, what more would you ask from a country?
Mm.
A country that's committed to carbon neutrality, being an oil producer. A country that is reforming, the whole social fabric of the country and making progress. A country that's taking governance, compliance, and improving how things are done in a proper way, whether in the government sector or in the private sector.
Mm.
This is true ESG. And I would love to see this framework really give a credit to the kingdom and its aspiration based on data, not based on subjectivity that you see some investors who lack knowledge about what the country is doing. Maybe a final point with regards to SABIC, that we're definitely happy and very active, with the framework.
Yes.
And we're also trying to demonstrate some of the things that we have on the ground.
Yeah.
So since 2015, we've built the biggest CO2 purification and capture unit globally.
Mm.
It is here in Saudi, it is here in Jubail. Definitely, it makes environmental sense and sustainability. It is also economically viable for SABIC. But from an ESG perspective, we haven't seen how this is really given credit to the company when investors want to invest in SABIC. As far as our committed to the framework, in a couple of days, next week, actually, we're hosting our Global Investor Day here in Riyadh. And the only external speaker that we're hosting is FII. To talk about the inclusive framework.
So we're definitely committed, we like it, and we would love really that all of us advocate for such initiatives and spread the word about the importance of how these frameworks would really make sure that investors can have the tools that they could support their investments in the emerging markets, which are critical for ESG.
Brilliant. I'm getting signals that we are out of time, but I would like to just say a few closing remarks, if I might, just to try and summarize where we've got to. It's gone quickly, hasn't it, guys?
Oh, so much more to say.
No, I know. And I'm sure everybody would love to hear more from us. And there is that opportunity. I'm sure if we can hang around, if you have any questions, I'm sure the panel would be delighted to answer any questions that you have. But in terms of the perspectives we've heard that this is absolutely critical for an investor that really wants to target investments in emerging markets at the right things. This is a critical lens through which to look at investments. We've heard how developing the tourist strategy and the investments that underpin that for Saudi Arabia, it's critical that you look at ESG performance in the context. We've heard from Oliver how this framework could be used in terms of developing new products for your customers and how actually this could be used to help target investors on the issues that matter most through those products. And Iyad, you know, how do we differentiate our business from another business that looks very similar in a developed market when we think we're doing better? How do we get that? So I just think you've been a great panel. Thank you so much. If you're interested in finding out more about the framework, go to the FII website. You can download it, look at it. If you're really interested in playing with it and engaging with it, we can also send you the tooling that sits behind that as well. So thank you. If you could offer the panel a round of applause, that'd be much appreciated.